Now let's look at some of the oscillating systems where the equation of motion derived would actually have some nonlinear terms in them. And in fact, they're very, very common. So we'll start with something that you guys are very, very familiar with, which is the case of a pendulum tied to either a massless light rod or to a string. Okay. So this has certain mass m. And what we're going to do is we're going to have it oscillate about equilibrium. So it's going to basically move along a circular arc. Right, so let's say we move it to an angle theta, right, so it gets over here, and this position, of course, we can show our coordinate system. So we'll say this is our tangent direction, et hat, and that's your en hat, okay. We'll write the acceleration in the tangent normal system as v dot et hat plus v square over rho en hat. So rho over here is fixed length, let's call this radius r. So rho is actually always equal to r. Okay, so that's the acceleration. And if we draw the free body diagram, in this position, we have et hat, we have en hat, and this angle is theta from vertical. So the forces acting on this particle are the tension. So let's show that. So we have the tension on the particle, and then we have the gravity, right? Okay, so if you do sigma f equal to ma, and this is basically just doing the stuff we learned in chapter 3, model 3 on kinetics of particles. So what are the forces? We have mg. So if we take this angle theta, so we have mg cosine theta and t, which are along the normal direction. So we have t minus mg sine theta, that's along in en direction, plus mg cosine theta, and that's actually negative, so let me write that as minus mg cosine theta et hat equal to m times v dot et hat plus v square over rho en hat. Okay, and remember our objective is to determine what the equation of motion would be, right? And this is still a single degree of freedom system because you need only one variable, one parameter theta, to indicate the position of the particle. So let's equate the coefficients of these unit vectors. We get t minus mg sine theta equal to mv square over r. And we get minus mg. Actually, I made a mistake over here. This is not cosine theta. This is actually sine theta, right? Because mg cosine theta would be acting along normal relation. So this is actually cosine theta. So this is cosine theta. This is sine theta over here. And this is cosine theta. Okay, so we get minus mg sine theta equal to m v dot, right? Okay, since our interest is really in the equation of motion, so we don't really care about the tension, right? So let's focus on this equation. So this is m times. Now v is equal to nothing but r theta dot, right? So v is r theta dot, so this becomes r theta double dot, right? Because v is nothing but r theta dot, right? This is moving along a circular path. So using the radial using the r theta system, we know v is going to be, you know, r theta dot, right? So what do we get? We get m cancels, actually, so we don't have any m. We get theta double dot plus g over r sine theta equal to zero. And that is the equation of motion. So this is the equation of motion for a particle tied to a light rod, massless rod, or a string, right? So if you look at this, this looks similar to what we had before for a harmonic oscillator. So what was the equation of motion for harmonic oscillator? It was x double dot plus omega n squared x equal to zero, and x was your variable. And of course, you know, if I replace x with theta, I get theta double dot plus omega n squared theta equal to zero, right? So if I just replace x with theta, so a position variable, which is a linear variable, change into an angular variable, we get similar equation. So if you compare this one with this equation over here, there are certain similarities, right? First of all, we have theta double dot as the first term. Then we have something as a coefficient, you know, which could be construed as omega n squared, right? But the crucial difference between these two equations is that here we have sine theta, while here we have just theta. Right? And this sine theta gives rise to nonlinearity in this equation. So that's why this equation over here becomes a nonlinear differential equation. Okay? Now, nonlinear differential equations can also be solved. There are techniques available that will allow you to solve this differential equation. But, you know, our goal in engineering is to really simplify as much as we can, right? So how do we simplify this further? One way to simplify this is to say that for small oscillations, so if angle theta, the angle of oscillation, is small, then sine theta can be approximated as theta. So if oscillations are small, and that's just putting it qualitatively, then sine theta is almost equal to theta, right? If you plot the sine theta, right, you know, sine theta looks something like this, then for small theta, you know, the sine theta can be approximated with this line. So you have this line, which is the y equal to theta line, right? So let's say this is f theta, and this is theta over here, right? So f theta could be sine theta, f theta could be equal to theta. So if theta is theta, we get this line, which makes an angle of 45 degree. So if you zoom into this area, you find that actually, you know, the curve in this area and this line almost match, okay? So if you zoom into this area, you see something like this. So you have the curve, and the curve begins to deviate after some theta, right? So this could be small theta. So theta being small, okay? So for small theta, you get sine theta to be almost equal to theta, all right? So it's an approximation that we are making over here. All right, so if we do that, so for small theta, sine theta is theta, then we can change this equation to theta double dot plus g over r theta equal to zero. Now, once you do that, this becomes similar to our harmonic oscillator, right? So in that case, now we can associate omega n square with g over r. So omega n becomes square root of g over r. And that's your circular natural frequency, right? We also know that omega n is equal to 2 pi over tau, the time period. So tau becomes 2 pi square root of r over g. So that's your time period of oscillation. And this is a result that you may have used in your high school physics experiment, where you may have tried to determine maybe the gravitational acceleration where the pendulum was set up, right? So you use a stop clock to find out what the time period was, and you made a few measurements, and you created your table of the time period. Then maybe you picked your average. You knew the radius of the pendulum, right? The length of the string. And then from that, you could find out what the gravitational acceleration would be. So, you know, this was a simple way to actually find gravitational acceleration. And notice that it really doesn't depend on the mass of the particle, right? So this is a nonlinear oscillating system, but for a small oscillation, for smaller values of theta, you can actually linearize this system. So this is called linearization of a nonlinear system. So what we've done over here is we have done a linearization of a non-linear system. And this is the kind of thing that we'll be doing, you know, quite often whenever we see non-linear term. So by the way, as an aside, so for small theta, sine theta becomes theta. What happens to the cosine theta? For small theta, cosine theta is actually equal to 1, because if you substitute theta equal to 0, you actually get 1, right? So cosine theta is almost equal to 1 for small values of theta. Okay, now let's look at rigid body. Okay, so far we have only looked at the physical object model as a particle. Now let's look at a rigid body. So we have, let's say, a rod. Okay, so we have a rod that is tied to a hinge like that. So this rod is actually allowed to swing about equilibrium. So it has certain mass, it has certain length, and we know where the center of mass is. Let's say this is a uniform rod of mass m. Okay, so how do we find out what is the time period of oscillation or the circular natural frequency of oscillation for this rod? Okay, so we'll employ the same technique. What we will do is we will displace it by a certain angle. Okay, so we'll displace it by a certain angle, let's say theta, from equilibrium. And then in this position, we will draw the free body diagram, right? So let's do that. So we have the rod. I'm going to remove it from its support, and that's your vertical line. That's angle theta. Center of mass, we have the gravity acting that way. Let's say this point is O, so we have O sub X, O sub Y. So we have, we basically picked a quantum system now, right? So those are the forces on this rod, right? What we can do is we can apply Newton-Euler equation. So sigma F equal to ma, and acceleration will be acceleration of center of mass. We can also apply sigma mg equal to ig alpha, okay? And since this is a rotation about a fixed point O, I can also use sigma m o equal to i o times alpha. right? So this IO is centroid mass moment of inertia about 0.0, which is the fixed point of rotation. So we'll use this equation actually, because we are interested in the equation of motion. Equation of motion should have the time derivative of the position variables. In this case, it is theta. So we will expect to see theta double dot, theta dot, and theta terms in our equation of motion, which we will get from this third equation. So let's take the moment about 0.0. No contribution from the reaction forces. So the only contribution from mg. So that would be equal to mg, okay, sine theta, because mg has a component, mg cosine theta that way, mg sine theta this way. So we can also show up a tangent normal system if we wanted. This is the tangent direction, this is the normal direction. So this is almost like the pendulum problem. So mg sine theta times, we have L by 2, right? And that would be a clockwise moment, so that's actually negative, equal to IO is m times L squared over 3, because we know that I sub g for a rod of mass m and length L is ml squared over 12, and I sub O would be ml squared over 12 plus m times L by 2 squared using parallaxis theorem, and that'll give us ml squared over 3 times alpha is theta double dot, right? Because it's d over dt of omega, and omega is theta dot, so that's actually theta double dot, right? So signs are very important over here. If you don't pay attention to sign, actually you'll get the wrong equation of motion, and then you'll never be able to solve for it, okay? So notice how we picked the counterclockwise direction to be positive, and then moment came out to be negative. So one of the things that is slightly different about vibration problem is that you can have the clockwise direction be positive as well, okay? So if you choose your direction of motion to be clockwise, then that becomes a positive direction, and then anything in the opposite direction becomes negative, okay? But just to be consistent with how we've been, you know, treating the clockwise direction versus counterclockwise direction, maybe you can always choose the counterclockwise direction as the direction where you will displace the rigid bodies in, okay? All right, so M cancels again. So what do we get? We get, you know, we have one L, one M cancels. We get theta double dot plus G, 3G over 2L times sine theta equal to 0. Okay. So again, you can see that this equation is fairly similar to what we opted before for a pendulum, right? So notice here we have G over R, right? And we have sine theta. And here we have 3G over 2L times sine theta. Again, this is also a non-linear equation because of the presence of sine theta term. So we are going to linearize this by saying that for small theta, sine theta is approximately less theta. So this becomes theta double dot plus 3g over 2l times theta equal to 0. And the moment we do that, we can see that this is a simple harmonic oscillator, which means the solution for this equation of motion would look like what we have seen before, to be theta m sine omega n t plus phi, where omega n is given by square root of this quantity 3g over 2l, right? Because if you compare it with theta double dot plus omega n square theta equal to 0, that's what we get. So equation of motion at least will give you the circular natural frequency or the time period right away. What it will not give you alone is the amplitude of the oscillation as well as the phase angle. And to get those, you will need some initial conditions. Let's do an example. So this is example 9.1. Finding the moment of inertia of a rigid body. So in this problem, you're shown a connecting rod. In this connecting rod, we have it suspended from the knife edge at 0.0 and displaced slightly so that it oscillates like a pendulum. Its period of oscillation is 0.77 seconds. So you're given the time period of oscillation as 0.77 seconds. The mass center G is located at a distance L equal to 110 millimeter from O. So we know L is equal to 110 millimeter. And the mass of the connecting rod is 661 grams. So we also know its mass, which is 661 grams. Using this information, determine the mass moment of inertia of the connecting rod about G. So we're looking for, so find I sub G, okay? And these are the things given to you. So this is a connecting rod. Now, you will recall that a connecting rod is a rigid body that connects crank of an engine with the piston in the cylinder, right? So that's the connecting rod that you have, and this is like the rough shape for that. And you're looking for the smallest mass unit of inertia. Now, it may look like as if this problem has nothing to do with vibration, right? If somebody gave you this problem, you know, outside dynamics class and said, find the mass unit of inertia, you would be wondering what has this got to do with the vibration, right? So how would you solve this problem? Well, you know, vibrations, you will see pretty soon, is going to be one way to solve the problem. But if this problem was given to you, like I said, outside dynamics, how would you solve it? Well, one of the ways you can do this is you can try to use your knowledge of how to compute the mass moment of inertia, you know, the basic formula for mass moment of inertia. And you can, you know, that involves basically doing an integration, and you can do the integration to find it, or you could use a composite rigid body technique. So you could decompose this body into some simpler shapes and find what the mass moment of inertia might be. But all those things may be a little bit too complicated to do, right? So you might take the easy way out, which would be to probably model this in a CAD software. And most of the CAD software is you can apply the material property, you can specify certain parameters, and it would compute the mass moment of inertia about different axes for you. So those would be, you know, a couple of ways you can determine this. A third way, which is what we're going to use in this problem, would be to actually use the knowledge of the oscillation of this connecting rod to find what the mass moment of inertia would be. Because we know that the time period of oscillation for this connecting rod would depend on the mass, maybe the length, as well as mass moment of inertia. So let's see how we'll solve this problem. So we'll start by displacing this by an angle theta, because this is a pure rotation. Okay, and this is where the center of mass is. And we'll draw the free body diagram, right? So if I were to you know, just write, show my reaction forces, I'm taking the easy way out over here. I shouldn't really be doing this with the support shown, right? We have to move the support to show these reaction forces. So if we have this, we can use the Newton-Euler equation, and I'll start by taking the moment about 0.0 like we've done before. So that will be IO alpha, right? So the moment about 0.0 would be mg sine theta times L by 2, and that's negative equal to IO times theta double dot. So we get theta double dot plus mg L by 2. So the 2 IO comes here, theta sine theta equal to 0, right? So we get this equation, which is clearly a nonlinear equation. So for small oscillations, we'll replace sine theta with theta. So we'll change this to theta, and we get theta double dot plus mg times L over IO times theta equal to 0. So once we do this, we see that this is actually a harmonic oscillator, simple harmonic oscillator, which has the natural frequency equal to square root of mg L over IO, right? So we know the time period of oscillation. This is equal to 2 pi over tau, right? So we know the tau. So tau is equal to 2 pi square root of IO over mgl, okay? So tau is given to you, m is known, g is known, l is known, so that gives you IO. So IO would be determined from that. But we also know that IO from parallaxis theorem is equal to IG plus m times the distance between O and G squared. So that's L, so that's L squared, right? Okay, so IO is known, ML is known, that gives you IG right away.